people, and I want to provide what details we do have around those shootings. This morning, a woman was found shot to death with multiple gunshot wounds inside of a tent at Pryor Road and Rawson Streets in Southwest Atlanta. The suspect was described as a black male, approximately 5'10 to 6 feet tall, 170 to 200 pounds. And I know this is a very general description. Last seen wearing a dark ball cap, a long sleeve white t-shirt, dark jeans, and carrying a drawstring type backpack. We are also asking for the public's assistance in identifying anyone in the area on Friday morning, June 12th, at around 9:40 a.m., where units were called to the area of 300 Ted Turner Drive on a report of a person who had been injured there. On the scene, officers discovered the body of an adult male who had suffered from at least one gunshot wound, and this was under the I-20 overpass at Windsor Street. And I'm sorry, those are two separate. I'm going to have Captain Price clarify these locations for you because I have Ted Turner Drive and also under the I-20 overpass at Windsor Street. Also on Monday, June 1st at around 1:40 p.m., officers were dispatched to Baker Highland, the Baker Highland connector northeast at Piedmont Avenue, to another person who had been shot as well. Again, we know that the first two incidents have been linked, and we suspect that the third is also related, and we are continuing to gather information, but ask for the public's help in providing any additional information that you may have, if there are any surveillance camera, video footage, or if you were in the area during any of these times. We ask that you provide that information, and again, I will have Captain Price clarify the times and the locations. We are also working with our continuum of care and our service providers to help ensure that we are communicating with our homeless population in the same way that we have done in other emergency events, to make sure that the word is out and that they are also on high alert. I again want to publicly express my condolences to the family of Rashad Brooks, and update you on additional actions that I am taking today on behalf of the city of Atlanta to address many of the issues that over the past few days have become abundantly clear are problematic within the city of Atlanta. As many of you all know, over a week ago, we announced the creation of a task force, and this was in response to President Obama's challenge to cities across the country to take a proactive look at our use of force policies and to make recommendations. That task force convened for the first time last week, and we anticipated having initial recommendations within 14 days, with community input and final recommendations within 45 days. On Friday evening, we saw the murder of Rashad Brooks. And as I've said before, I am often reminded of the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. There is a fierce urgency of now in our communities. And that fierce urgency of now says that while our advisory committee continues to work to make recommendations to help us implement and review all of our policies in the city of Atlanta, it is clear that we do not have another day, another minute, another hour to waste. And so as we look forward to receiving the very thoughtful recommendations, and I appreciate their work, in the interim, I am signing an administrative order, a series of administrative orders today, calling upon our Chief Operating Officer, Joshua Williams, to coordinate with the Interim Chief of Police, Rodney Bryant, to immediately adopt and implement reforms of the standard operating procedures and work rules of APD concerning their use of force policies. Specifically, these reforms must comply with state law concerning the use of force, and they will include addressing APD's officers' response to resistance generally and specifically regarding the use of deadly force in accordance with the principle that officers should use only the amount of objectively reasonable force necessary to successfully protect themselves or others, to effect an arrest, or to bring an incident under control when dealing with members of the community, suspects, detainees, etc. I'm also requiring de-escalation generally and specifically prior to the use of deadly force, in accordance with the principle that officers should use de-escalation techniques to gain voluntary compliance and avoid or minimize the use of physical force, and to continuously develop, update, and train officers in de-escalation techniques. Also requiring the reporting of all uses of deadly force by a police officer to our Citizens Review Board, adopting and implementing a duty to intervene, whereby if a police officer sees another officer using force that which is beyond reasonable under the circumstances, that they are duty-bound to intercede and prevent that use of force and must immediately report the use of such force to an on-duty supervisor, and also provide lawful restrictions on when an officer may use deadly force toward a suspect who is in a moving vehicle. We understand in Atlanta and across the nation that this is the beginning of a great deal of work that lies ahead of us to make sure that we are doing all that we can do to protect our communities and to follow the principles that were set forth by the Obama-Biden administration on 21st century policing. It's very clear that our police officers are to be guardians and not warriors within our communities. We stand on the strong legacy of civil rights in this city and in this country. And it's for that reason I am also signing an additional executive order that will hopefully allow us, as we continue to grieve and show our frustration and anger as a nation, that will create the framework that will allow us to move to action. And in an effort for us to develop a succinct appeal for human rights, I am signing an administrative order that will convene a body to begin to succinctly articulate our grievances and what we see as our solutions. We hope that this will be a framework in Atlanta and possibly the nation. The actions that I am taking today are a continuation of the criminal justice reform efforts that I began at the beginning of my administration as mayor, which have included the elimination of cash bail bonds in our city, meaning if you get stopped for a traffic ticket and you don't have $200 to pay, you don't stay in jail simply because you are poor. It's also meant that we have asked our City Council to reallocate a significant portion of our corrections budget towards community-based programming, because after we closed our detention center to ICE, it gave us an opportunity, along with the elimination of cash bail bonds, to begin to reimagine and to begin the work to transform our city jail into a center of equity, health, and wellness. And I believe that it is more important than ever that we continue that work in earnest. As we continue to work with our advisory council on the use of force, we expect our first recommendations by June 24th, with final recommendations by July 24th. And it is my assurance to you that we will continue to do the work that we need to do to make sure that all of our communities each and every person in our community is treated with dignity and respect. We saw the worst happen on Friday night with Mr. Brooks. It angered me and it saddened me beyond words. But I know that it is my responsibility as mayor of this great city for us to continue to work to put that anger and that sadness into action. And so this is the first of a series of actions and steps that we will take. And I look forward to continuing to work with all of our community stakeholders so that we can begin to heal as a nation and as a city. But as someone who has experienced the sudden death of a loved one, I know that there are no words and no actions that will ever bring them back and will ever fill that void. But I do hope that the public and all of our community partners know that there is a deep and abiding commitment on behalf of this administration to make sure that we're doing all that we can do so that another child does not miss the opportunity to have her father present on her birthday. So with that, I'll take any questions that you have, and I'll also turn it over to Chief Bryan and to Captain Price. So let me just say, based on what we saw happen on Friday, it became abundantly clear very quickly that there is a need for us to take an immediate look at our training policies. So some of these policies, in my opinion, while we are speaking these policies, they are not necessarily integrated into our training. I'm going to let Chief Bryant speak in more detail on the difference on what our current standard operating procedures are and what the difference will be given this administrative order.
Good afternoon. Based on the policies that are being set by the administration and the police department, the alignment are very close. But the executive policies are actually a little bit more detailed, and there are a few more requirements as opposed to the standards that we have currently. Right now, there's no defined indication that one has to intervene in an act, and that executive policy does spell that out directly. You're now seeing that throughout many police departments are going to that model based on what we saw happen in the Floyd case, where officers have to now intervene with other officers when they see something that may not be appropriate. Well, and as well as for us to, being that this is an executive policy, for those policies to change, generally what you have is a policy that is created through the police department, and we have the authority to change it as we deem fit. But an executive policy requires us to go through the mayor's office and have that level of conversation before we can change that policy.
And I'll just add something to that. Part of the debate in looking at the shooting from Friday night is, was that training, is that how our officers are trained? If someone has your taser, do our policies then allow you to respond with a weapon? And so again, as we are taking a look at our use of force policies through our advisory committee, it is abundantly clear that through my executive powers, we need to reiterate our desire that there be de-escalation and that there not be an immediate use of force when there are other options that are available. And to the extent that we need to codify that, and to the extent that we need to formally change our standard operating procedures, this executive order, this administrative order, is a first step. Well, City Council will not be need to be involved, from my understanding, with our operating procedures as it relates to our police department, but as it relates to anything that needs to be codified, certainly that will have to go through the legislative process and approval. You know, just like with the officers who were previously charged, that's a decision from the district attorney's office. What's before me is working to implement policy and to change our operating procedures in the city of Atlanta. That decision was an independent decision made by a separately elected district attorney, and I'm sure in the same way this decision will be made. But I have said this privately to the district attorney, and I will say this publicly. We have other use of force cases sitting on the district attorney's desk, including at least two with men who were shot in the city of Atlanta, and we have not gotten a response or a path forward on those cases. So if it is his will to take a look at this case and go forward with criminal charges, it's just my request that he look at all of our use of force cases that are still pending in the district attorney's office so that we can have offer some finality for those families as well. The morale is bad right now. My understanding is that it's really bad, and understandably so. It's bad across the country because of what's happening across the country and the scrutiny and focus and a lot of the anger and frustration that's directed at our police department. And I don't think Atlanta is any different, and I think you layer on, you know, I spent Saturday afternoon looking at body cam footage. This is the third time in 2 weeks that I've spent the better part of a day looking at body cam footage related to excessive use of force. So it is bad. But what I will say to our officers is that there is a shift of expectations across this country, and that shift will be no different than here in Atlanta. And I think in the long run, it will be better for the men and women who work within our Atlanta Police Department if we are very clear on what our expectations, our policies are, so that they can also be clear in return as to how they are to police and partner with our communities. And I can't say this enough. We have a police force full of people who work each and every day alongside our communities, they are a value part of our communities. They are greatly respected within our communities. They volunteer at our Police Athletic League with our kids. They volunteer at our At Promise Youth Center. But clearly, the fact that I am standing here speaking about the shooting and killing of a black man who was sleeping in a drive-thru restaurant shows that there is a significant disconnect, and it's incumbent upon all of us to make sure that we address that disconnect. And I would just say it's in the same way. At some point in the nation, we had to look at how we dealt with domestic violence cases, how we dealt with sexual assault cases. It is the same evolution, I believe, that police departments across this nation will have to take as it relates to racial interaction between our officers and how we police in our communities. You know, what I will say is my anger and my frustration matches theirs. The difference is that I am using the bully pulpit that I have as mayor to effectuate long-lasting change in this city. But I am equally, if not more, concerned. I'm equally mad. I am sad. The entire range of emotions to watch Mr. Brooks on Friday night talk about wanting to go home for his daughter's birthday. It breaks my heart. And there is nothing that I can say and that I can do as mayor that will bring him back and that will change what happened on Friday. But what it does mean is that I will continue to try each and every day to make sure it doesn't happen again. And what I will also say, and what this is something that Carolyn Longbank said to me, who was a part of our city council for many years and was also one of the organizers of the student movement in the 1960s. She said, stop calling them protesters. They are demonstrators. So we have to be careful the language that we speak. And by and large, we've had peaceful gatherings in this city. Burning down buildings will not get us change in the city, because if anything, it is going to erase the message, and it is going to eclipse what this is all about. And the Wendy's that was burned down, 40 people from the community who worked inside of that Wendy's, a minority-owned Wendy's. And we also have pictures that we put out of the young woman who burned down the Wendy's. And we also have a reward for her arrest, because the reality is, and I heard Joyce Shepherd say this today, this is a food desert that we're standing in. That's one of the few fast food places in the entire area. So not only is an employment center gone, but also a place that somebody can go and get a salad is now gone. Those are the things that the demonstrators need to think about and call out the violence on our streets. People are frustrated, they're crying out, I'm frustrated. But there has to be a better way, because we saw it, we've seen it before. We saw it with the civil rights movement, and we saw the change that happened in this country. And it did not happen by us burning down our own communities in our cities, and it's not going to happen that way today. All right. Ryan, it broke my heart. I mean, I lost my father at 24, and I still cry about my daddy. And I would venture to say, when I saw him run, if you all haven't watched the entirety of that body cam video, he talked about his daughter's birthday. And the first thing I thought when he ran was that he probably didn't want to be locked up over the weekend. And I know that because I know I've had family members in that position. They get locked up on the wrong day for something stupid. It didn't have to end that way. It didn't have to end that way. I mean, it's you know, it pissed me off. It makes me sad, and I'm frustrated. And nothing I can do is going to change what happened on Friday. All right. Thank you.
Okay, yeah, no problem.
All right.
go outside and on your way so you don't. 1 second, please. You need to get y'all out here safely before you get stuck inside here because they'll be coming back.
Okay.
I just don't want to get y'all stuck inside here.
Okay, that's fine.
All right.
Thank you, Michael. Yeah. All right. So we gotta get out.
All right. I guess let's just go back towards the car then, because yeah. I need